this guy. Cheech, thanks so much for being here.
My pressure.
Good to see you. Your pressure?
Yeah, well, I get 100 hours of court-mandated community service knocked off for doing this.
Yeah, that's exactly what this is. What people don't know is that the celebrities come here, it's part of community service after they get arrested.
The system works if you work the system, you know?
So what prompted you to write this book? I love this book. I love any time that you get out of playing a part, be it the part in Cheech and Chong, but when you came in, you had your book of art, and now this book, it's a really great way to showcase sort of how well-rounded you are as an individual.
Well, thank you. It was money, actually, that made me do this. And so
you're not getting those up in smoke checks anymore.
Well, there's never too much money, you know. So I was doing an art talk in San Diego, and there was a literary agent in the crowd. She said, "Hey, you know, all these stories you're telling, they'd make a good book, and so I can get you a deal." So perk, you know. And so that's what we did. And I wanted to kind of get these stories out, anyways.
So now there's a part in the book where you meet screenwriting legend Waldo Saul, and you ask him, how do you write a screenplay?
Yeah.
And he says, "You see that secretary over there? She follows me around and takes down everything that I say." So how do you write a book?
I said, borrow the secretary, obviously. I just started on these stories. I didn't want to the day I was born, I didn't want to start from there, but I wanted to tell about that. So because I came from a particular neighborhood. So I started in the middle of my predicament. I was in Canada. I lived in Canada for 3 years, and it was right in the middle of the Vietnam War and all that stuff going on. I was really heavily involved in the draft resistance movement, and so we were protesting and causing a lot of commotion for the government, and they were after us.
You talk about the sort of environment at your college at the time, which was a state school in California. And you had sort of all of the big hitters in terms of revolutionary movements at that time, right?
Yeah, we had this speaker series, and Eldridge Cleaver came, Reyes Tierin, Cesar Chavez. But the one that really got to me was David Harris. And he was the head of the draft resistance movement. And the philosophy was, you stop this war by not participating in it. If you haven't registered for the draft, don't register. If you're registered and you get called up for the physical, don't go, and keep resisting every. And so the philosophy was to clog the system, and it worked. And it worked. It clogged the system pretty well because the bureaucracy was, you know, you made it work against itself.
Now, your father was a cop.
He was a cop. LAPD, 30 years.
LAPD, 30 years. What did he think when you started getting involved in these leftist commie groups at the...
Well, you know, it was really typical of the attitude of a lot of people. He says, "Well, I don't believe what they're doing over there in Vietnam, but if they call me, I would go." And then that was his, because he was a World War II vet, you know, in the Navy. And I said, "Well, that's the dividing line between our generations. We're asking questions, and if we don't like the answers, we're not going to act on whatever's being forced on us."
Well, we kind of see that. We kind of see a version of that now, right? Where see a kind of resistance forming against the travel ban or against a number of other things that Donald President Trump has put forward, and
it's hard to say that, huh?
It is. And then at the same time, we see a lot of the mainstream people who say, "Well, you know, he is our president, and thereby we must abide by his version of law and order for the next 4 years."
You know, well, Nixon was our president too, and so was Reagan, and I didn't like either of them. But, you know, he was a president, and you kind of go along until you find something, "Hey, I can't go along with this," you know. So that's, you know. But I was watching this documentary on CNN the other day about the 60s, you know, the 60s, the 70s. And looking at the 60s and the 70s, man, people were really getting killed. You know, Martin Luther King, Medgar Evers, Bobby Kennedy. Bobby Kennedy spoke a week before he was killed in my school. And Kent State students were getting killed on campus, and then the SDS was blowing up buildings here in New York, so it was a lot more revolutionary than it is today.
You know what?
Cold in here.
It's so cold in here. Thank God. Thank you for saying that.
I didn't want to think I'm shaky.
I've been saying it all week. Maybe if Cheech says it now, we can get some heat in here, guys.
Dang.
One of the massive differences, and we'll get off this and talk more about specific stories in the book. about the revolutionary period of the 60s versus, I think, now, is when you talk about the 60s and what people were fighting for then, they weren't just fighting for civil rights, they were fighting for economic rights. And those two were inextricably linked.
Yeah.
And I think that's where so much of the revolution came from at that time. And you don't see that anymore. You don't see people fighting for economic and civil rights and sort of recognizing that the two are
the
inextricably linked.
The big issue and the dividing factor between the generation was the institution of the draft. And historically, that's a real big dividing issue. When they have the ability to call your ass up and send you to 3,000, 5,000 miles away to die in a jungle, you start to question, well, wait a minute, what am I going for? This is, I can't see any purpose here. I was to stop the domino theory or, you know, it's like, and they started asking questions. And they were facing the baby boomers, which was the biggest generation yet to come in the United States, and we were going to assert a lot of clout from then on.
Whereas now we have a volunteer army that we send in 9, 10, 12 times to just keep going back.
And the need for an army kind of dwindles, you know, when you have atomic bombs and or asymmetrical warfare, you know, or guerrilla warfare. You don't need this, like, 10,000 people to land on the shores of Normandy. You know, you just need 25 guys to raid a compound. Yeah, exactly. 25 guys to write a screen there, yeah. So
one of the things that I found really honest about your book was the way that you talked about your relationship with Tommy. Mm. You're very open about, you know, some of your grievances with him, some of the disagreements that the two of you have had over the years.
Yeah, well, you know, in any partnership, I don't care what if you're selling pretzels or doing comedy or anything. There's going to be disagreements, especially in a creative environment. You know, I would like my idea, and I don't like your idea. Well, how do we work together? And that went on all through the period. The thing that really escalated was movies, because it really, there's definite areas that you're in charge of or not in charge of, and the director is the head guy. And so we had always directed and written together, and then at some point he decided he wanted to be the director and dictate everything that was going to happen. I'm going, yeah, I don't think so, you know. So we kept fighting that fight until it fell apart, you know. And it was, well, if that's the way you think, go and do your thing, and I'll do my thing, and it's a beautiful thing.
When it fell apart, did it feel like it could fall apart because both of you had firm grounding to do things on your own? Or did it feel like this has gotten to a point where it's so bad, even if I can't find something to do on my own, we got to walk away from each other?
You know, it was like, during our relationship, I had always been there for them. No matter what we were going to do, we argue, we fight. But at the end of the day, whatever we decided, I was going to do. And I asked him to do one thing for me, be in the Born in East L.A. record, and he wouldn't do it. And so, you know, you're not going to show up? You're not going to show up? No. Okay, I'll do it myself. And that one thing led to another. It was inevitable, because the record went into a video, and the video went into a movie, and he wasn't in any of them because he didn't want to do it. So I guess here I am.
I want to backtrack. I think I got ahead of myself, because one of the things that, and I told you this in the green room, that I really like about the book is this idea of you not necessarily setting out to be a comedian when you left out into the world, or even becoming an entertainer, but just because you were a person who was curious and willing to work, you met more people, you had more adventures, and then they led to something where you thought, okay, this could be I could do this.
Yeah, you know, that's exactly how I've lived in my life. To this day, I just do the next thing that comes up. But if you put yourself in the crossroads or in the intersection, waving your hands in a fluorescent suit, you're going to get hit by dumb luck. But it takes a lot of effort to get there, you know. So I just kept doing that, and one thing led to another. And I was raised Catholic, not only in the religious sense, went to Catholic school, but in my appreciation of everything. I had a Catholic knowledge of a lot of different subjects, and so
you were going to be a priest until you started making out with girls.
Yeah, you know, the boing factor popped up, and you know, so no, I you know, couldn't do that. But I was, you know, I really liked being raised in that kind of a belief system. I'm not now, but I appreciate all religions and all belief systems and anything that anybody has to center their life around to. And I've talked to a lot of my friends. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is a very good friend of mine, and I asked him why he was a Muslim. He says, because I needed something to center my life around at that time and under to focus. And I said, well, cool, you know, and you do a lot of good with four people in that auspices.
Do you feel like the generation now miss, not that they do it, not that it's done on purpose, but is missing out on a certain kind of adventurous spirit that a fair amount of the boomers had in the mid-60s to mid-70s, where you could hitchhike, you could go across the country, you could go to New York and get a job as a dishwasher for a few years and be able to pay your rent living in the middle of New York City and still be sort of be a part of something that was happening. Do you feel like there's an adventurous spirit like that that's kind of missing?
In one sense, because it was all new when we were doing it. This is the baby boomers, and they were rising up against conformity, you know, the post-World War II conformity, and everybody was in lockstep, and you went to college, and you got this job, and you were in the man in the gray flannel suit. And then although my generation said, well, I don't want to be in a gray flannel suit. I want to kind of, and there was a certain amount of people that came back from the war that they didn't either. So there was this, it was the extension of this bohemian culture, you know, that I want to do something related to art or, you know, a free way of living or some way they lived over in Europe. They had seen those things. And so there was a rebellion against that and so on that, and we were this giant. We were the pig that got swallowed by the python, you know. And all during its life, you're going to see this pig move through a python, you know. That it still looks like a pig, and it was a big deal.
Now you have kids and you have grandkids now, right?
I do, yeah.
And with your kids and grandkids, do you try in some ways to impart onto them a sense of adventurousness, or is that something that you had and you're like, no, you be safe, you stay home with us?
No, I the thing that I try to impart to my kids is to work, to be responsible and get up in the morning and whatever it is. I always tell them, I'm a Chicano, I have to have three jobs. So, you know, you got to at least have one job.
What three jobs do you have going on right now?
Right now I'm doing a book. I'm on tour with Tommy Chong after all these.
Cheech and Chong on tour.
I must have another. Oh, I'm involved in the art world heavily. You know,
so collection.
Those are going good. And I'm writing. I'm going to continue writing right now. That's hopefully this book will be successful and they'll pay me again.
Haven't you guys pitched and are working on a potential another movie?
You know, I don't think that's ever going to happen because it's still a question of who's going to be the director, and you know, it's like, and I'm not going to. I can't get into that anymore. I mean,
you guys can't just get another director who could oversee the two of you, and
I could.
Got it.
As a showman, what I wouldn't give to have Tommy here and to just feed this fight a little bit in front of people.
Yeah, well, you know, that's been going on for a long time. I mean, we get along now, but even when we've been now back on tour for 8 years, you know, thank God for casinos, man. You know, it's like there are more Indians now that own casinos than there were when Columbus landed, you know. I mean, and they're everywhere. And that's revived that kind of show business, you know, and so it's interesting. I think every act or everything has a shelf life, especially in comedy, because it's so ephemeral and mercurial. Mercurial? There we go. And you're the zeitgeist or the voice of your generation only for six movies.
And only
for if you're the most successful comedians, or a comedian of a generation. And then
Pryor had it for a few movies.
Yeah. And then it moves on to the next that is the voice of that generation or that age set. You know, and it keeps moving. You can be funny and keep working and keep, but as far as the zeitgeist of the generation, it keeps moving.
You have this wonderful moment in the book where you get to interview Richard Pryor.
Yeah.
And for my money, whether it's cliche or not, I think Richard Pryor is the greatest stand-up comedian of all time.
I think the same thing.
Yeah,
I've seen him a lot.
I never got to see him live. I'm too young, I guess, even though I probably don't look it. But he's incredible. And one of the things he says to you is, it's not my job. Wait, what is the actual line? It's my job to tell you what Richard Pryor sees.
Yeah, he says the most important thing, not what Richard Pryor does, it's what Richard Pryor sees. And it stopped me.
Or who Richard Pryor is.
Yeah, who Richard Pryor is. And I don't care. It's what Richard Pryor sees. And it stopped me in my tracks. I go, oh, wow. So that's the most important thing, you know.
But did you find that Cheech and Chong was... different than that? Because so much of Cheech and Chong's comedy, in my opinion, is about who they are. I mean, sure, it's what you see as a person that is making Cheech and Chong as characters, or the characters that they play. But it's different than, I think, the prior approach to it in turn.
Yeah, yes and no. I mean, because what we chose to make scenes of comedy on was what we saw. We saw street people. We saw this. We saw people in power. We saw each other. We saw Latinos before anybody had seen it, and or black people before. We had a big black following from the beginning and up until this day because we came from black culture. I was raised in an all-black neighborhood, and Tommy was raised in an all-black neighborhood in Canada, and he was with Motown, and I sang R&B all my life, and to this day we have a big black following. And when we got back to LA, when we came down from Canada and started, we played nothing but black clubs, because they had this old format, you know, a professional MC would come out and introduce a professional comedian, and then the floor show. And we were talking about dope, you know. So we had a willing audience there. And to this day, I was just, talking to Ice Cube in the dressing room. And those kids grew up watching Cheech and Chong movies. And because there was a certain black sense of humor, certain black sensibility that has always been a part of our act without calling attention to it.
You know, early in your life, you said you talked about growing up in a black neighborhood, and at one point, your father moves you and your family to a slightly more upscale, probably middle class neighborhood, right? Which is mostly white.
It was all white.
It was all white.
One day everybody was black, and then the next day everybody was white. Oh, how does this work?
And you talk about the poor neighborhood as a stressor. You know, every day was stressful. There were sirens and patrol cars going down the street and fights, and you know there was a shooting that your father was involved with next to your house at a barber shop. And then you moved to this other neighborhood, and I'm curious, when you look back, what did that other neighborhood provide for you in terms of the future Cheech Marin?
I started going to Catholic school at that point, and when I first the first when I got first to Granada Hills, I was in a public school, and they hadn't seen a lot of Mexicans. I mean, forget about black people; they hadn't never seen a black people. And the first day I was in school, I was sitting on the bench to play tetherball, and these two kids came up and said, "Hey, Blackie, move to the back," and pushed me off the bench. I said, "Blackie, but no, you got to see some black people first, you know, because this ain't playing, you know." And I got in a fight first day, but then. They got me into Catholic school, and they didn't play that, you know, and they just played corporal punishment, you know.
Yes. Everybody got beat at Catholic
school. Everybody
got
beat. And so but it allowed me to concentrate on my academics and to participate in sports.
And I think that's such a valuable lesson, because we live in this country, in this culture, where the political climate is that no matter what economic class you're from, you can pull yourself up by your bootstraps and make something of yourself. And it's so interesting that halfway through your childhood, you move to this neighborhood, which offers you a certain amount of stability that helps you succeed.
Well, there wasn't a lot of shootings in Granada Hills, you know. It was like, but in South Central, where I came from, there was shootings all the time. You know, I saw two homicides right in front of my eyes by the time I was seven, and it affects you as a kid. It scars you, and you're always afraid, you know, because like these guns are going off and the sirens going off, and there, you know, there's people, there's dogs behind things, and it's like, and, you know, you're a little kid.
Before I move on to audience questions, I didn't know this, but one of your oldest friends that you talk about in the book is the one Geraldo Rivera.
Yeah. That was just with him last night.
Were you really?
Yeah.
How is Geraldo doing right now? His head must be spinning.
Yeah. The big revolution for me was, you're a Republican? How's that work? You know, he's fine. I mean, he's had a long career in doing.
You guys fight about politics a lot?
Not at all. Not at all. Not at all.
You just don't talk about it?
He's very kind of realistic about the people that are involved in that and that thing. And also he's involved in the news, and so he has to be kind of analytical about it. And so I don't begrudge anybody their political opinions. It's just when it starts to get encroaching on my political opinions and my life has to conform to the agendas they lay down. It's the same when I was 20. You know, I ain't going for this. Right. You know, and I'm going to do something about it or not do something. I can't go for this.
I love how you and Geraldo met, right? He came running up to you and was like, hey, I think we should be friends.
Yeah. We had met once before in New York, and he was doing this charity one-to-one, and he had a telethon for it. And, you know, and Tommy and I were passing through New York, and we were on it. And so, coincidentally, he moved in next door to me in Malibu, where I was living. And I looked up when I was laying on the beach and see this guy running down the stairs, and it's him. And he says, hey, we should be friends. You know, because we're bi-coastal Browns, man, and we should be friends. I said, you're right, we should be, and we have been. I mean, more than friends, we've been family. All our kids were raised together. We got married together, divorced together, married again together, and all our kids are the same age. And so we've shared each other's lives throughout for almost 40 years.
You know, you tell these great stories in After Up in Smoke, where you and Tommy meet with, like, Sherry Lansing, and, like, if people don't know, Sherry Lansing was the head of Paramount. She was the head of Paramount. She was the first female CEO of a major studio. Unbelievable woman. Also married to William Friedkin for a period of time, I think, too, right?
How does that work?
I have no idea. But the way that you tell these stories of pitching these movies is so interesting, because it's such a different industry than you go to a house or to an office, there's four people, maybe three or four people. You pitch a bunch of ideas, they come back and say whether or not they want to do it. And now getting a movie greenlit seems like a process of going through marketing, sales, all these different departments. It's such a corporatized business.
It's such a process. I don't know how people get anything made nowadays. You know, it was very free-floating in those days. The only factor that was the bottom line factor, did your movie make money? And if your movie made money, they would do another one, because our movies didn't cost anything, but they made a lot of money. So it was like we would make a deal based upon a 3-page script. I mean, and it wasn't 3 pages of scenes; it was 3 pages of ideas. And we want to do this scene, this scene, this scene, this, and they would budget it. They would sit down with the computer. Oh yeah, well, how many days are you going to be there? Oh, 3 days. Oh, that's like $150,000. And they because they had a number in their head of what they wanted to make this movie for. They wanted to make this one movie for $3.2 million. And they did all this process. Okay, that scene there, and you'll be there, and you have a car there. Let's see. Oh, it comes out to $3.2 million.
What was the biggest budget Cheech and Chong movie?
I think $3.2 million.
What was the lowest? Was the lowest Up in Smoke?
Yeah, Up in Smoke, yeah.
What'd you guys make that for?
When we stopped shooting, it was $800,000. Not bad, and then when Adler had it for a little while, and about $1.5 million.
That's not bad for 1978.
It was, but we weren't making it under the studio system. We had a negative pickup deal in which some entity, we're still trying to find who that entity was, put up the money, and then we completed the movie and then gave it to the studio, and they would buy it back from us.
When did you start, we'll move on, and I've talked to you about this before, but I think it's so cool. When did you start collecting Chicano art? Because your collection is amazing. People go online, look up his books, or just Google search Cheech Marin Chicano art. It's a beautiful collection.
Oh, thank you very much. 1985.
And what prompted that?
I had been educated in art all my life, self-educated from a very early age. I think I was 11, around there. And I had this little group of cousins that were very intelligent, and we challenged each other, and we would try to learn together. And my one cousin, Louis, who was the head of it, he assigned us topics. Okay, you have history, medieval history, you have music, classical music, and pointed to me, and you go find out about art and bring it back to the group. And so, okay, so I went to the library and took out every art book they had, and that's how I visually educated myself. Okay, that's Miro, that's Picasso, that's Jackson Pollock. And so I knew all that, but I didn't know anything about contemporary art. And so I started going around to galleries in Los Angeles, and that's when I discovered these Chicano painters. And it was like walking through the jungle and finding the Beatles. You know, like, wow, these painters can really paint, because I knew what good painting was because I'd seen it all my life. And these guys are good. How come they get no shelf space? You know, because they're Chicanos, you know, and they weren't considered fine artists. They were considered agitprop folk artists. And okay, so they're as such, they were shut out.
It's a weird niche to put them all in, because a lot of the Chicano art that you have it encompasses so many different kinds of art and so many different movements. Like any contemporary art, you can feel a very educated idea of artistic movements.
Well, all these artists in the groups that I collected are either a university and or art school trained. So they were influenced by international art, by classical art, by Mexican art, by anything that was out there available that any other art student was available to. And they would put their own Chicano bent on it. You know, it's like, there's this one painter, he is the father of graffiti, Chaz Bojorquez, and he came out of L.A. And I told him, I said, yeah, they viewed you guys as agitprop folk art. And he goes, what's agitprop folk art? He didn't even know, man, because he was doing this graffiti, you know, and it was amazing.
It's such an, you know, racism exists everywhere all the time, but it's fascinating that even in the art world, they find a sort of somewhat racist box to put these incredible artists in so that they don't have to validate them.
You know, that's it, because the wheels of any modern museum grind slowly. And it's the final imprimatur of acceptance into that general society or into the aesthetic of a society in general, you know, and to admit some other, to admit beans in your diet is a different deal, and it takes a lot for them to move that, you know. But
it's also a greater conversation about representation, right? Because if Chicanos were represented in the art world more, just as collectors or as gallery owners or in museums, that art would probably be represented a lot more in those spaces as well. Because at the very least, you wouldn't have old white people who've only been trained in European.
Yeah,
art,
exactly.
Responding,
you know,
to it.
When I was a little kid, I'm sure everyone in this room has had the same experience. When you're in grade school, they put the same color T-shirt on you and take you to the Metropolitan, and you hold hands and you look at everything they got, all these paintings of, you know, warriors and gladiatorial warriors and fighting these classical battles. But you don't see anybody that looks like you. Especially for Latinos, I never went to the County Museum. I went to the County Museum of Art, and never saw anybody that looked like me on the walls or my neighborhood or anything. So I guess I don't exist, or either I don't exist, or they're not talking to me.
Yeah. I'm fortunately incredibly well represented everywhere all the time.
I have nothing against white art.
there's
some
literally
a couple of things that are pretty good. You know,
I can look anywhere, and I'm literally represented.
Yeah.
First question.
Hey, Cheech, I loved you in the Martin Scorsese movie After Hours, and I want to know if it was written in for you or just a coincidence that your character respected art.
No, it wasn't written for us. It was written by this guy, Joe Mangrum or something. We shot it here in New York, and it was his doctoral thesis at NYU. And the reason we were in it is Martin Scorsese, when he was talking about this script to his crew. And so he said, these two guys, and they're burglars, and they come along, and they're like Cheech and Chong. And he kept saying, like, they're like Cheech and Chong. And he goes, wait a minute, I know Cheech and Chong. I'll give him a call. So he called me. And so he was saying, tell me what do you want to do? I said, yeah, sounds good to me. So we came in and did it.
It's a better pitch than the one you got from Ron Howard and Brian Grazer in the book, right? It's an amazing story where Ron Howard and Brian Grazer pitch Cheech and Tommy like a terrible movie idea.
They were the very first starting out. They were young kids, and they had not made a movie yet. But they were hoping. There was this team. Ron Howard was going to direct, and Brian Grazer was going to produce. Come over to the house, they pitched me this thing, and it's just, okay, Cheech and Chong are raised by turtles. And they don't know that they're not turtles because everybody around them is turtles, and like they flip on their back and they can't right themselves because they're turtles. I don't know.
Like everybody was smoking a lot of pot at this time. Like everybody.
I don't know if maybe that's for us, man, because I don't really see myself as a turtle. But what it exemplified is in the movie industry, if you're a hit or have a thing, they will come at you with everything because you're a hit. Doesn't make any difference if, you know, well, these guys are zombies from outer space, but you'd be great in it, you know, because if you say yes, I can get this movie made.
Right, we already have this property that we have the rights to. You get in here, we can start making a movie.
Yeah. And it wasn't just, you know, relegated to them. Tony Richardson, it's in the book too. Director of one of my favorite movies, Tom Jones. He was a wonderful, classic British. And he came in with a script, and he said, I'd like you have to play two English guys, so you'd have to act. Okay, well, we're not acting now. And so I don't think we're going to be English guys, but don't you see what we're doing? You know, I was thinking in the back of my mind, don't you see what we're doing? Like, that we want to do that.
You know? Yeah. How do we fit into what you're talking about?
Yeah, exactly.
Here? Next question.
Hey, Cheech. I was wondering, how often do people call you by your real name? And how did you come up with the names Cheech?
Chicharon? Nobody calls me by my real name except my mother, and she's gone. My real name is Richard, Dick for short, although not really. And
you let people call to go with Dick? Did you ever let people go with Dick for short?
No, I never did.
That was such a your generation. I'm Richard, and that's such a your generation thing to go with.
I resisted it because in baseball, I played a lot of baseball, Babe Ruth, Little League, high school ball, and they always want to call you Dick because they're baseballs, I know. And so I said, and I was resisted, right? No, that's not my name. My name is Richard. And they're like, just trying to be friendly. But my real name, my nickname is Chicharon. And Chicharon is, I'm sure a lot of people here know, the little deep fried pig skins and pork rinds. And when I came home from the hospital, as any new baby, I looked like a little curled up Chicharon, man. And my uncle looked in the crib and he says, ay, parece un Chicharon, you know? And it looks like a Chicharon. So that's my name in the family, because everybody in my family had at least three names. And so it got shortened to Cheech, because they didn't want to see Chicharon every time. And so when Tommy and I were trying to figure out a name for our now duo, because we came out of a group, it says, and we couldn't, you know, Marin and Chong, Richard and Tommy, it says, do you have a nickname? I said, well, in my family, they call me Cheech. Cheech and Chong, Cheech and Chong. And that was it. And it was that recognition, because we were musicians. And it scanned, Cheech and Chong, Cheech and Chong. It wouldn't scan Chong and Cheech, because it's, you know, it's out of rhythm. And so we both recognized it right away, Cheech and Chong. Yeah, that's it.
I think we have time for one more right here.
Hey, Cheech. So I was wondering, like, when you wrote the book, was there any parts of your life that you just didn't want to share with other people, or was it just, like, just too obscene?
Do you expect him to share them now after he didn't put them in the book?
No, I shared every aspect, except there's some aspects I didn't go into as fully as others. And it's not what you would expect. It's how to explain different wives with the current wife looking over your shoulder while you're writing this, man. And you know what that's about, you know?
Wanting a lawsuit.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, I don't need the grief, you know? So I try to kind of show respect to everybody that I've been involved with, but, you know, kind of shine an extra special light on my wife now, you know, which, I mean, and you have four different children with three different wives, and anybody who's ever been in that situation know what's happening there, man. There's no right answer, and you're never the good guy, and you're like, but you try to work it out with your kids, you know. You have to, you know, talk to them directly, and then they kind of get over it, because there's this other side of the story that's being, you know.
Did you ever have trouble with that, and you had to sort of work your way through it?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. From the beginning, it takes a long time, you know, because they're being influenced by somebody else that doesn't live under your roof.
It's really the long game. Like, you have to know the long game. I have a friend that's going through that, and he's kind of like, the kid hates me, it's not his kid. And I'm like, just, if you're going to be in this relationship, play the long game, because she will smarten up.
Yeah.
She's 20, 21, and you guys will be friends.
Absolutely, that's what happens. And I used to compare it to, like, standing in the forest with a lump of sugar in your hand trying to get the deer to come here. You know, come on, deer. Come on, deer. And you got to stand out there for a long time. It's like the guy in the commercial is just tired of holding the mic, you know? I can't hold this. And you got to stand there, and you have to let them come to you, and they will. If what you're telling them is for their own good or for both of your own goods, they will do that.
Absolutely. Cheech, I love having you here, man. It's so much fun to talk to you. Is the book on shelves right now?
Yeah, right now. You go out and you have to buy 5 or 6 copies to really get the whole story. So, like,
Cheech is not my real name, but Don't Call Me Chong by Cheech Marin is on books now. Cheech Marin, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.